tackling Ephesians chapter 1, verse 9 to 10. So that is what we will do today, right? That's what we'll do. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 9 to 10. Just to tell you, the Lord has given me a privilege to pastor our church in Vancouver. If ever you are in Vancouver, British Columbia, come by and see us. We'll promise to take you around. If you want to see some rain, more rain, go to Vancouver. I'm also privileged to be a part of the regional council, to be serving the Lord in that capacity. So every now and then, as part of the regional council, I meet with the regional council, and we have meetings after meetings to discuss how we can help churches all over Western Canada. And every time I come, I get the opportunity to just swing by and be with you. So Ephesians chapter 1, verse 9 to 10. Starting from verse 9, allow me to just read it, and then we will pray after that. Making known to us the mystery of His will, according to His purpose, which He set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time, to reunite all things in Him, things in heaven and things on earth. Would you just join me in a short prayer? Father, we truly ask in the name of Jesus that You would empower all of us to comprehend and understand that which is beyond understanding. Accept through the mighty revelation of Your Holy Spirit. So we ask now that You would empower us to understand Your words. Hide Your servant behind the cross of Christ, that only You and only You and Your word will be exalted. And no one else. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. 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 Well, the very scripture that we're about to tackle this morning is right there before you. As you notice, it starts off in the middle of something, like verse 9 says, making known. So it's very obvious that it is coming from somewhere, and perhaps even if you don't have it there, you would like to perhaps read verse 7 to 8 with me. Just read it with me. I know you have tackled this, I know you have studied this, but it will be beneficial for all of us to just go back, verse 7, 8, 9, and 10. Let's read it again. All right. In Him, we have redemption. He has set us free. How? Through His blood. Yes? The forgiveness of our sins, that was the result of that. According to the riches of His grace. Why did He do it? Why did He do it? Well, He did it because of His riches, of His grace, which He lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight. He did not sprinkle a little bit of grace here and there to us, but He lavished it upon us, making sure in all wisdom and insight that we will have everything that we need so that we can come to Him. And then verse 9 is a manifestation of all that, making known to us the mystery of His will. Well, what is the mystery? What was that will? Well, the redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of our sins, making known to us the mystery of His will, according to His purpose, which He set forth in Christ Jesus. All right, there's so much to say. There are several points I want to bring to you this morning, but perhaps just to start off, just so we will join the Apostle Paul in his line of thought, would you turn to someone and say, you are so blessed. Yes. words and say, for real. How do you turn this back? How do you turn it back? Left? Oh, okay, go left. Okay. Okay, oops. Yeah, I've chosen to entitle this study as simply coming from the word one. And you will understand why. Because the plan of God comes to one, bringing us together, making us together, and bring us together as one body of Christ. But that will be coming later on. The whole chapter of Ephesians chapter 1, especially from verse 1 to 14 and onwards to 15, when Paul prays, Paul gives us the spiritual realities of being in Christ. And he is saying, praise be to God who has blessed us with every spiritual blessings, yeah? He has blessed us with every spiritual blessings in Christ. And of course, he tells us how we were chosen in love, he predestined us, and how he has lavished upon us his grace. And now he tells us that a part of that blessing is that God made known to us the mystery of his will. So it, when you put all of this together, the Apostle Paul is telling us the spiritual reality of our blessing. That we are really so blessed. You are so blessed. And it is for real. You may not see it or feel it at this time, but that is the spiritual reality of being a Christian. You are so blessed. So blessed. For real, in fact, that is what we see again, making known to us the mystery of his will. Now, allow me to just talk about a few things before we go to several principles that we see in the passage before us. The first is that phrase, making known to us, right? Making known to us. All right. So when you encounter the word know, immediately you would think about making something clear to your mind. Yeah, making known to us, or something that is brought to your attention, making known to you. But in the Greek, the word known comes from the word ginosko, and it doesn't just refer to knowing something here. But ginosko really is experiencing something. Alright? So when the scripture says making known to us, what it is telling us is that God allowed us to experience that. He's not just saying he has made something clear in our head. No. He has allowed us to experience his will. And what was that will? The forgiveness of our sins. I see some good friends there from Vancouver. They just came from Vancouver. I say hello to you, my good friends. Coming early this morning, I woke up at 5 in the morning, and my wife Joy prepared me light breakfast, oatmeal as usual, a cup of coffee. I tried not to eat too much because there was one travel that I had from Vancouver going to Toronto. I ate a whole plate of sinangag, and then egg, fried egg, and a little bit of something else. And when I came to the airport, I was just so sick. I had to go to the washroom several times. But this morning I had a light breakfast. But then again, on the plane I was feeling a bit so weak. Oh, really weak. I was really weak. So, but when I saw Wayne, I felt the energy. I felt the energy. Especially when Wayne says, "Pastor, have you eaten your breakfast?" And then he gave me an idea of what to expect. He says, "Let's have breakfast." Boom! I felt a little bit of strength, and although physically I was already weak. But when he says, "I want to take you to breakfast," immediately my mind was thinking about importance. McDonald's, or what was that Japanese restaurant Edo. My mind was fast forward. I was anticipating something that I was about to experience, and therefore I had strength. This is what you do for your children, isn't it? When your kids, do you do this? When your kids are restless, and you don't know what to do with them, what do you do with your kids? You give them an idea of what to expect. You tell them, "What do you want? What do you want? You want McDonald's? You want Tim Hortons? You want Toys R Us?" And then immediately the kids would, and they begin to focus, and they begin to follow. Is this not what God is doing here? Paul, through the power of the Holy Spirit, is laying out to us, giving us an idea of God's will, of what to expect. And therefore, when we see the will of God, we become more stronger in the inner being, focused on His will. There is a difference, by the way, I'm sure there is a difference when someone says, "I have seen Game 7 of the Cavs and Warriors, I've seen it." But there's a difference when someone says, "I was there."
Oh, yeah.
Yeah? When someone says, "Oh yeah, I know, yeah, Cavaliers won." That person knows. But there's a difference when someone says, "I was there." That someone has experienced it. Yeah? So the making known really means that God has allowed us to experience His will, and that is the forgiveness of our sins through His blood. Okay. Now let me just discuss the mystery of His will. When you talk about the mystery, this is not in reference to something so enigmatic or something so mystical that you don't get to understand it. Yeah, because when you encounter the word mystery, the word mysterious comes. Yeah, it's a mystery. It's mysterious. It's enigmatic. It's hard to understand. But again, the word mystery here, it doesn't refer to something hard to understand. It is a mystery because of its depth, because of its richness. That is why when you think about the grace of God, it is a mystery, not because it is hard to understand, but because of its depth, the depth of God's grace, the richness of God's grace. That is why over and over again the Apostle Paul, even Ephesians 2, would say the immeasurable riches of His grace. That is why it's a mystery. Napakalalim po ng biyaya ng Diyos. Napakalalim po ng pag-ibig ng Diyos. It's a mystery. Now the word will, let me just go through this quickly. The word will, it refers to something that God intended not just through reason, because of his heart. He desired it not because of reason, but because of emotion. It came from deep down inside his heart. Now, there is a difference again when someone says, oh, let's go to the Philippines because it's been a while since we've seen our hometown. But when you say, let's go home to the Philippines or go back home so that we will see Nanay or Mommy, so we will see Daddy because we have not seen her for a long time. There is so much emotion there. Yeah? Can you see? Can you see? It is not just reasoning, but it's coming from the heart. So here, the will refers to his love. The will refers to the heart of love coming from God. So when you put this all together, making known to us the depth, mystery is that will is his love. The mystery, the depth of his love. Making known to us the depth of his love. Mystery is a divine truth known only to God's people through divine revelation. It also refers to God's purposes of redemption hidden before. It was hidden before. Henceforth in his counsels, but now revealed to us. There are many scriptures that tell us just that. So here God makes known to us the mystery of his will. Having that together, let me just offer to you a few principles that come from the scripture that we have, if we can see it again. All right. The first would be, okay, this. This becomes so obvious from the scripture that we just read, and we were just expounding this. First is this, you never have to doubt the depth of his grace and love for you. Would you turn to someone and say those words? You never have to doubt the depth of his grace and love for you. Well, where did it come from? Well, it came from those words. The words mystery, the word purpose, the word making, according, known, set forth. It comes from those words. You never have to doubt. I don't know about you, but there are times in our lives wherein we wonder if God is there. You know, when the doctor comes to you and tells you something that is just mind-blowing, that you don't know what to do, and at that moment you're saying, where is God? And listen, I don't know what you are going through. I want to tell you, you never have to doubt the depth of his grace and love for you, for he has already demonstrated the depth of his grace and love when he died on the cross of Calvary. This goes back to verse 7. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our sins. That, my friend, tells us the depth, the richness of God's grace and love for you and me. Last December, if I may just share quickly, last December, my wife was diagnosed. Just quickly, I won't give you the details. My wife was diagnosed with breast cancer last December, and like you, Mary, much like you, it was the toughest news that one can ever receive or know. Last December, and it was doubly tough for me to keep preaching every Sunday, preparing the message of the Lord, encouraging people, making people strong, encouraging people, saying, don't give up. But well, at the back of my mind, my wife needs to wait for what the doctors will say. February, she was scheduled for surgery. But to cut the long story short, my dear friends, I want to tell you that glory be to God, my wife is cancer-free today. Amen. Cancer-free today. Cancer-free. And Ella, you're next. You're next. We pray, we ask the church to pray, and God heard. My friends, you never had to doubt God's love for you. I don't know what you're going through. The depth and the richness of God's grace, my friend, is so rich that you never have to doubt. You never have to doubt. He is forgiving. He is gracious. He is sovereign. That is why you're so far from God, or maybe you feel guilty of something that you have committed, and all of us go through that. We're not perfect. You know, you do something, you say something you regret in saying or doing, and sometimes you feel like you're so far from God, and maybe you remember the words and the prayer of David when he says, "Oh God, create in me a clean heart, or restore to me the joy of my salvation." I want to tell you, my friend, you can start again. You can begin again. Whatever you have done, you can ask for forgiveness. He is quick and just to forgive. You can come again to Him, and the Heavenly Father welcomes you with open arms. You never have to doubt His grace and love for you. So much to say. Amen. I hear that. Amen. God, thank you, babe. I needed that. Thank you, Lord. Here's another one. Okay. Alright, here's another one from the text we have. Divine purpose is not only comforting. It is comforting, yeah? But divine purpose reveals the truth of the existence of an all-knowing personal Redeemer God. You know, the atheist or even the agnostic will tell you, well, of course it's comforting when someone tells you it's going to be okay. Of course it's comforting, they will say. They will argue, of course it's okay. It's you know, if someone tells you, you know, it's going to be okay, we'll be okay, we'll be fine. That is comforting. But the agnostic and the atheist will argue, but is it true? But I argue today, yes, it is true, sir. It is true. Divine purpose is not just comforting, it is comforting, but it is true. It is true because it reveals the existence of an all-knowing, not just all-knowing, personal, intensely personal, Redeemer God. Look at the purpose that you see in all creation. Just think about, you know, by the way, in verse 9 and 10 of Ephesians chapter 1, Paul mentions to us heavens and earth. Okay, let's just talk about that, the creation of God. We were just singing about that this morning, about the creation. I forgot the title of that song, but we were singing about creation. But think about the purposes in God's creation. Look at the stars, look at the Milky Way, look at the galaxies, look at all of these things that we have in the heavens. The sun and the moon give us light. Even Jupiter, by the way, the planet Jupiter, the gravitational pull of Jupiter, did you know that that is a purpose? The purpose of that is to draw away all the meteorites that will hit the Earth. If it was not because of the gravitational pull of Jupiter, all of these meteorites will come and hit us. And if it hits us, we'll be toast. Everything has a purpose. And we see this in the creation of God. the scriptures will tell us, Psalms 19 will tell us, the heavens declare the glory of God, the skies proclaim the works of his hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they display knowledge. It tells us of the Creator God. He is the unifier of matter and energy, the creator of hyperspace working in perfect precision. He is the creator and agent that guides the complex, ultra-sophisticated, finely tuned universe that we have. Can you imagine this? That the billions of stars right there, out there in the universe, is finely tuned. By who? By the Creator God, the eternal Logos, the ultimate designer of all things. Think about your body. Do you remember the systems we have in our body? Why it is functioning the way it is functioning? Do you remember your high school biology? How many systems do we have? That we have a circulatory system, we have a skeletal system, we have the muscular system, we have the digestive system, we have the respiratory system, we have the nervous system, we have the excretory system, we have the endocrine system, we have the reproductive system. This, my friend, is full of purpose versus what other people would say about random, unguided cells. Random, unguided creations. That is not what we see. What we see is purpose. Purpose tells us the existence of God. By the way, the 3.5 billion genetic alphabet in your body, can you think about this? It's all in order. 3.5 billion genetic alphabet in your body is all in order. And who did that? Well, I think it is us that we see a divine God with purpose. And he has, my friend, he has the wisdom that you need. Where do you take your car for repair, Tim? To the dealership. Well, why do you take it to the dealership? Because Tim will say, well, I trust the experts. Yes? That's where you take your car. Where do you take your tools in the house for repair? Take it to the expert. Where do you take your guitar for repair? Well, you take it to the expert. You don't want to go to the one who is not qualified. You go to the one who is qualified. Well, I present to you, my friend, you can bring all your cares to God. He's qualified. He's qualified to counsel you. He's qualified to give you wisdom. He's qualified to give you insight. By the way, he created the heavens and the earth. If you can help me with the third point, okay, the next slide. This, again, pops up from our text this morning. Jesus Christ is the eternal Logos by which all things came to be. John 1:1 will say, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And in verse 14, it will tell us the Word became flesh. That is obvious, that is Jesus Christ. In him was life, and nothing was created without him. All things were created through him and in him and for him. He is the eternal Logos by which all things came to be. Think about this. Think about this. How would the purpose be accomplished? Going back to our text. Making known to us the mystery of his will according to his purpose. And what followed? What followed after that? which he set forth. You remember this part? Which he set forth in Christ. How would the purpose be accomplished? Set forth in Christ. He planted through Jesus Christ, his Son, his only begotten Son. How would the plan of redemption come to be? Through his Son, Jesus Christ. But that is not just redemption. Think about creation. Oh, God accomplished all this through the eternal Logos, and that is Jesus Christ himself. There is a recent discovery, by the way, in the scientific world. They call it gravitational waves. Have you heard about gravitational waves? Gravitational waves. Okay, you remember your high school science? The theory of general relativity, Albert Einstein? Okay. Alright. Gravitational waves, discovered just recently, confirms what Albert Einstein was saying. That the gravitational pull that we know is because of the curvature in space and time. There is an unseen curvature. Okay, curvature that changes the geometry of the waves that come to us. Now, just recently, the scientists of what we have today discovered gravitational waves. Can you picture, if I have a pebble, a stone, and we have a pond here, a pond, okay? And if I drop the pebble, what do you see in the water? You see what we call as ripples. Yeah? You see ripples. You see waves. But so much to say. But what does it imply? Well, the gravitational waves recently discovered points to the fact that there was a beginning. It confirms what Genesis has always been telling us in the beginning. God created the heavens and the earth. Nowadays, actually, in the scientific world, they are trying to suppress that finding because it is pointing to a beginning. And they were saying, if it points to a beginning, it points to the existence of an all-knowing God. My friend, this all-knowing God is not just all-knowing. He is a personal, intimately personal God. He wants to be personal with you, my friend. He wants to be with you. He wants to hear you pray. He wants to commune with you. And he invites you to come to him, draw near to him. He's not just personal God. He is also Redeemer God. He wants to set you free from what is ailing you, from what is burdening you. He wants to set you free from your sin, from the power of sin. He is an all-knowing personal Redeemer God. Creation cannot be denied. Creation says, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The eternal Logos, Jesus Christ. And all things came to be because of Him. I think we can take one more. At what time do we have until 4? 2:30. Okay, I think we can take one more. Okay, thank you. Would you turn to someone and say, he has a purpose and plan for you? Now, this becomes so obvious in the text before us. Much the same way a composer of music composes things and puts the notes together and the rest and the rhythms together and the melody together and the dynamics together. He puts all of these things together, but when you look at it, it doesn't make sense. When you look at it at first glance, you would say, it doesn't make sense. Until you see the finished product. Well, my friend, his purpose is to bring all things to an incredible finish. The words incredible finish, we're borrowing it from the Apostle John, or John the Elder from the book of Revelation, when John the Elder would say, he's the Alpha and the Omega. How many of you remember that? Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. One of my Greek teachers would tell me that, did you know that the word Omega, well, we know that Alpha is the first letter of Greek, and Omega is the last letter, but that's not just it. Omega comes from the word two words. Mega, which is great, awesome, okay? And O, meaning the great one. Mega, which reminds you of a mega mall, your mega mall here, mega deal, mega sale, yeah? But more than that, it refers to an incredible finish. Jesus Christ, Alpha and the Omega, he is the one who is bringing all of this to an incredible finish. Paul will tell us before creation, redemption was on his mind. Remember this. Look what the scripture would say. Look at what Paul would say. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world. Many times you don't understand God's plan, but suffice it to say that God has a purpose and a plan. He is the potter, and we are the clay. He loved you before you came to be. Oh, that's too much. Think about, really? Well, that is what the scripture says. You were on his mind before you came to be. Remember that song? Before the world began, you were on his mind, and every tear you cried was precious in his eyes. Because of his great love, he gave his only son. Everything was done so you would come. Let's take it further. Perhaps we can take two more. Help me here. One more slide. Okay, everything is coming back to the one who gave you everything, Jesus Christ. Everything was created through the eternal love of Jesus Christ. Everything came to be because of Jesus Christ. Everything that he has created will come unified. This is what Paul was saying in verse 10. Look at, if you remember verse 10, in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 10. He says, what is the plan? The plan is for the fullness of time to unite all things. Look at this, verse 10. To unite all things in heaven and things on earth in Christ. He is the finished product. The finished product will always point to the purpose of the Creator. That is the plan. To unite all things in Jesus Christ, the eternal Logos. From Genesis we see he is the beginning. John will tell us he is the eternal Logos. And what is the ultimate goal? There's so much to say, but let's just jump to the next one. The ultimate goal is this: glory to God. The ultimate goal is glory to God. And that is what you find in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20 to 21. Glory to God in the church, in Christ Jesus, in all generations. All of this would come to the apex of the discourse of the ultimate goal. The ultimate goal is glory to God. Glory to God. That is why we exist, for the glory of God. This life is for the glory of God. Your life and mine is for the glory of God. But really, what Paul was saying, glory to God in the church. That is why it is so important that we join together every Sunday, glorifying God. Also, this church becoming partners with other churches who are glorifying God. We are just one body. There's just one body. There are many names of denominations, but there's just one body of Christ. That brings glory to God. That's the whole purpose. We're not building our own kingdom here. We are not building MCC kingdom. We're not building Church of God kingdom. We're not building Assemblies of God or Foursquare kingdom. We are building the kingdom of God for the glory of God, that all men might know that there is an all-knowing personal Redeemer. Glory to God in Christ Jesus, in all generation. To bring all of this to a close, we'll bring it to a close, and that will be the next one. And this will be, I think this will be the last one. Oh, would you go back to the, okay, there you go. You are, and several clicks. First, you are on a mission to glorify God. Would you turn to someone and say, you are on a mission to glorify God. And I'll proclaim, you are a new creation to unify. To be in unity with others. And one more click, you are each gifted for a reason to edify. I would leave to you to study Ephesians chapter 4, and that is what we see. Paul will bring all of this to Ephesians chapter 4, where he says, keep the unity of the body in the bond of peace. Okay. He expounds all of these blessings, the spiritual realities of our position in Christ, but then again he brings it to Ephesians chapter 2 when he says, we have been made one. No more Gentiles, no more Jews, but one in Christ. One new man, one body in Christ. And then he brings it forth in Ephesians chapter 3. He would say, oh, that we may understand the depth of God's love for us. Glory to God in Christ, in the church, in all generation. And then he brings it to Ephesians chapter 4. And then he says, therefore, and then he would say, therefore, live a life worthy of the calling that you have received. That is why we say again, I'm going to bring it to a close. We say again, theology must always lead to doxology. The more you know of God, the more you praise God. The more you offer your life to God, the more you bow down to God, when you realize the existence and the enormity of God's love for you and me, the more you bow down and surrender. Live a life worthy of the gospel. Walk as one. Walk worthy of the gospel. And all of this, I would say, all of this is just echoing the words of Jesus Christ. And if you may just give me the last, the very last, okay? Echoing the words, but not just words, but the prayer of Jesus. When Jesus was with his disciples and he was praying, he prayed this prayer. God, that they may be one, even as you and I are one. And Paul thinks that. Paul expounds on that and says, we have been made one one body in Christ. I'm blessed to see Barry among a congregation of mostly Filipinos. Have you learned of any Tagalog words? I'm sure you know Tagalog words.
Guapo,
ikaw.
Salamat.
But I'm just saying, my friends, this church has a great opportunity to reach all nations, all ethnic groups, all nations, all ethnic groups out there who need to know that there is a God who died for them on the cross of Calvary. Reach them, touch them, tell them that Jesus Christ loves them. And if you are here for the first time, maybe you've never heard of the gospel before, I tell you once again, God loves you so much. You never have to doubt His love for you. He loves you, and He wants you